Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The first scripture this morning comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 29 through chapter 12, verse 2. It's a common theme that I see if you can find. By faith, they crossed the Red Sea as if they were on dry land. But when the Egyptians tried it, they were drowned. By faith, Jericho's walls fell after the people marched around them for 7 days. By faith, Rahab the prostitute wasn't killed with the disobedient because she welcomed the spies in peace. What more can I say? I would run out of time if I told you about Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and the prophets. Through faith, they conquered kingdoms, brought about justice, realized promises, and shut the mouths of lions. They put out raging fires, escaped from the edge of the sword, found strength in weakness, were mighty in war, and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Others were tortured and refused to be released so that they could gain a better resurrection. But others experienced public shame by being taunted and whipped. They were even put in chains and in prison. They were stoned to death, they were cut in two, and they died by being murdered with swords. They went around wearing the skins of sheep and goats, needy, oppressed, and mistreated. The world didn't deserve them. They wandered around in mountains, deserts, caves, and holes in the ground. All these people didn't receive what was promised, though they were given approval for their faith. God provided something better for us, so they wouldn't be made perfect without us. So then let's also run the race that is laid out in front of us. Since we have such a great cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let's throw off any extra baggage, get rid of the sin that trips us up, and fix our eyes upon Jesus, faith's pioneer and perfecter. He endured the cross, ignoring the shame for the sake of the joy that was laid out in front of him, and sat down at the right side of God's throne. And now there's a children's moment, so if the children would come up. God apparently is doing it. Good.
We have faith that he performed miracles. We have faith in the scripture. we know that this is the root of our church, right? But we know that they're there. We know that God is there, even though we can't smell it, taste it, and touch it, with any of our senses. But we know that he's there through the experiences of love that we have, and by the good works that we see in our daily lives, right? And we have, just like this, we have faith in our parents, in our siblings, in our family and friends, that gives us comfort. But faith in God, in the scripture, we learn that faith in God gives us more than just comfort. It gives us, it gave them the ability to walk through the sea and break down walls by their own horns. It was just amazing, amazing accomplishments that were done through faith. So never keep faith, always growing. Let us pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for being here this day to celebrate and worship your name. We ask that you continue to bless our lives with faith, a growing faith, to grow in love of everything that you have done for us. In your name, Jesus, we pray.
Show us that the world is full of division, violence, and hatred.
but I don't hear Jesus' voice in those headlines. Yet, here we have scripture from Jesus' ministry that speaks very plainly to the point that Jesus was bringing division, and not just any division, but division to families. This is an agitating scripture, and I don't feel comfortable with it. However, I think we can find a different perspective if we step back and take a look at the context. Remember, Jesus is on a deadline. Jerusalem is waiting. The crown of thorns is waiting. The cross is waiting, and Jesus knows it. Jesus has a short amount of time to accomplish a world-shattering ministry. Jesus says all this before, but with a lighter touch. We hear Jesus speaking of division while teaching Nicodemus, a Pharisee and leader of the Jews. Jesus says, those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Division. Saved. Condemned. Light. Dark. Good. Evil. Believers. Non-believers. Jesus is telling us that you can't sit the fence with faith. You have to pick a side. You have to move from where you are to a new place, to a new life, to a new faith. Remember that Jesus was preaching to the Jewish nation, a nation of Moses and David, a nation of Elijah and Isaiah, a nation that had been waiting for a Messiah for centuries while holding fast to a rich religious tradition. It doesn't take much imagination to see that accepting Jesus as the Son of God and promised Messiah was a recipe for division in families. Think about our politics today. I'm sure that most of us have a list of friends that we don't mention Donald to. And we have another list of friends that we don't talk about Hillary. For the past 8 years, the name Obama has not been mentioned at my family gatherings without a tirade from one family member. And that's just politics. Jesus is upsetting the apple cart with what Jews believe about God and how they practice their faith. But did he have to say it that bluntly? I hear Jesus' frustration in this passage. He has tried the kinder and gentler approach. He's tried the story approach in the parables. He's performed miracles. He brought the dead back to life. People still don't get it, and time is running out. If you back up to chapter 12 of the Gospel of Luke, it's actually the lectionary that we heard last week, you get a clearer picture of why Jesus might be frustrated. Jesus has just told his disciples a story of servants staying ready while the master is gone. This story concludes with the words, "You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." Next, a question from Peter. "Lord, are you telling this parable for us or for everyone?" Peter, Peter, Peter. He doesn't ask what he needs to do to be ready. He doesn't ask how he can help others to be ready. Peter asks the question that no teacher wants to hear. "Do I need to write this down? Is this going to be on the test?" My dad used to say that before you talk to the mule, you get the mule's attention. Maybe this scripture from Luke is Jesus' way of getting the mule's attention. Now let's flip that coin over and look at the other side. The scripture from Hebrews was written to comfort new Christians during the tumultuous beginnings of the church. It is believed that the author of Hebrews is either Barnabas, partner to Paul during his first missionary trip, or Apollos, an Alexandrian by birth and a Jewish Christian with notable intellectual and speaking talents. Whoever wrote Hebrews, he did an excellent job of comforting these agitated new Christians. The opening paragraphs of this scripture read like a faith hall of fame. The parting of the Red Sea, the walls of Jericho, Samson, David, Samuel, Daniel. There is talk of conquering kingdoms, realizing